It's just a science project.
Silent breed is people!
You know, a doctor friend once said the same thing to me. Frankenstein was his name.
It's alive! It's alive! It's alive!
That sounds like something out of science fiction.
Please explain to me the scientific nature of the whammy.
You live in a spaceship, dear.
So?
Yes, science!
Program complete. Enter when ready.
Hello and welcome to Science on Top. This is episode 353 for Monday, the 16th of March, 2020. I'm Ed Brown and I'm joined by Penny Dumsday.
Hello.
And Lucas Randall.
Hello.
And the only reason we're able to do this show is because of all the generous donations from our Patreon supporters. All you have to do is go to scienceontop.com/donate and you can sign up to donate $1 an episode or more. You'll only be charged when we release an episode, and you can put a limit on how much you donate each month, so you'll never go over budget. And let's begin, Penny, because as a young mother, I'm sure you're aware that some kids don't like getting their vaccinations.
Oh my gosh.
And certainly anyone who's ever seen some anti-vaccination propaganda would understand why. They always have these photos with huge, scary-looking needles that look like they're more suited to tranquilizing a horse than saving a child's life.
That's basically what it's like.
Yeah.
I think it ruined my firstborn's faith in humanity. Like, he was just 4 months old. He smiled at the nurse and then she jabbed him in the arm and he's just world...
screamed.
Just world ended.
And that look of just utter betrayal.
Yeah,
face.
Yeah.
I trusted you.
Well, fortunately, Professor Maria Croyle from the University of Texas in Austin has been working on alternative delivery mechanisms for vaccines, some of which are a lot more, shall we say, palatable. Do you want to tell us about this?
I see what you did there.
Thank you.
So what has been developed is a really lightweight film that is peelable, it can dissolve, and it can stabilize biological materials like viruses, bacteria, antibodies, and enzymes, all the sorts of things that can be found in a vaccine. And it can also withstand temperature changes. So essentially, this film, you know those breath freshening strips?
Oh, yeah, like...
It looks a bit like those, like... You put it in
like
your mouth.
Like those Listerine strips that dissolve, yeah.
Yeah, Listerine strip things, that's the ones. And it's very, very fine and thin, but it can carry vaccines. So this is just fantastic. It's topical, I guess, like one day when we get a coronavirus vaccine, it can probably carry that. But it seems to be able to carry pretty much anything. So what's special about it is it's not tailored to one particular vaccine. It's been described as a kind of plug-and-play platform where once you know what a vaccine needs, it can be, the film can be adapted to basically suspend and seal the vaccine in the matrix and release it in a really controlled way. And this is important for so many reasons. Like in my way, I think how fantastic to have an alternative to needles, because obviously needles are very scary for a lot of people and it makes a lot of stress around getting vaccines. If it wasn't a stressful process, who knows if people would still be as opposed to it. Like it's hard to see your child in such distress, even though you know it's life-saving.
Yeah.
But the really important thing is that vaccines are actually really hard to distribute to certain populations, people in low-income countries where there's maybe not a lot of refrigerated shipping, where lots of people live in remote areas and things like that, because vaccine vials are 1,000 times the size of each one of these little strips. They require refrigeration. They require trained people to administer them. They require storage and so on. So apparently storage costs and shipping costs for vaccine and drugs makes up about 40% of the cost of drugs. So what this means is that vaccines could, you know, be distributed a lot more easily. They could be almost posted around the world, you know, anywhere the postal service gets. I mean, I don't know about the ethics and logistics of that, but just the potential. You know, instead of needing a refrigerated truck, someone could ride them out on a bicycle in a cardboard box and have enough to serve villages. Because if you think about places like, for example, you know, the highlands of Papua New Guinea, there are some places that are super inaccessible, like even today. So I think this is just really, really exciting. It would not just increase survival rates because more people are vaccinated, but it would mean that we could get huge populations vaccinated a lot more quickly and easily with this new delivery method. It could be a real game changer. So I'm really excited to see how this is going. And I guess not just for vaccines, but any drugs, sure, really, that can be taken.
I think that's incredible. I didn't realize 40% of the cost of a vaccine is just the storage and transport of it. That's
and amazing. I'm sure that depends, you know, from vaccine to vaccine and this and that, sure, place to place. But yeah, but I mean, that's a huge chunk.
But if you're buying something off Amazon and the freight costs half as much as what you buy, you watch and go, oh, that's ridiculous. Like,
no, thank you. I'm not paying for shipping.
But also, I mean, if this can just be, you know, you put it on the tongue and it will release it in time and dissolve and then it's gone. The waste that you're saving, because you don't have to have glass vials.
All those little bottles and the needles and the danger of contamination and everything like that and, you know, infection and, yeah, it's massive.
That's incredible.
It will create a bit of a dilemma for the people who make the anti-vaccination posters, though, because without those great big needles in the photos and the screaming baby, I guess it'll have to sort of start you know, focusing on the, you know, it just tastes wrong or something. I don't know, like that. You know, it doesn't seem as threatening.
Don't worry about them too much. Like, crazy finds a way.
But that is...
is that, should I not say that? Is that inappropriate?
No, I think it's totally fair.
Should we be worried about listeners who might be, probably not.
I think they're
probably not listening to
me. Our colours are on the wall. I think if you're listening to us for a while and you think we're on the fence about vaccination, you've not really been paying attention.
Thanks for coming, Bart.
You mentioned the taste, though, Lucas. So I'm wondering, what is this sort of made of? Is this going to be one of those really foul-tasting medicines that it's also going to be hard to get kids to take, or is it like a lolly? Like, it's, they sort of, they described it as sort of like, you know, your toffees that you might get because it's made of sugars and salts and stuff. So I'm wondering if it's, you know, can I have the toffee pertussis vaccine or something like that?
Oh, that'd be nice.
Well, that'll have another impact because often doctors will give like a little lolly to the children after being having their shots. So now it's like, well, now the shot is the lolly. What are you going to do?
This is so exciting. I'm really, really interested in this. It's one of those things like, why has it not happened before? This has obviously taken years and years for them to work on. I think they said somewhere that they began working on this in 2007.
Yeah.
Worth it. Very, very exciting.
Definitely.
All right, Lucas, let's talk some space history now and the formation of our moon, which has always been something of a mystery to astronomers. The, I think, most widely accepted hypothesis suggests that a Mars-sized object called Theia smashed into a very young Earth, sending up a huge cloud of debris, formed a ring around the Earth, and over time coalesced and accreted to form the moon. But until now, that's been somewhat circumstantial. We didn't have much concrete evidence, and there were some issues with the theory. But it did seem to tick a lot of the boxes and was a fairly reasonable explanation. What's happened recently that changes that situation?
So, as you said, it does tick a lot of the boxes, and that's why it is the leading hypothesis as to how our Earth-Moon system came to be as it is. Theia, as you mentioned, named incidentally for the Greek mother of the moon in Greek mythology. It's believed that this roughly Mars-sized object called Theia, you know, struck the Earth in somewhat of a glancing blow, so not a direct impact. And that's important because in order to end up with the system that we currently have, they've run many, many computer simulations of this, feeding the data into the models. And remember, we talked about models a lot on the show. I have, because I really like models. But one of the key things about models is they need to be able to predict what you see. So if you're talking climate models, obviously you have your inputs, and then you let the model run and say, does it predict what the climate was at this particular point in time for which we actually have observations?
Sure.
And if it doesn't match the observations, then you know the model's wrong. Now, we do have observations of the moon and the Earth, which we're on. We've been to both places, and we've looked at both places from the other. We've got sensors on the moon that we can measure its distance from us. We know quite a lot about how the Earth-Moon system acts, and we also know how it acted in the past. There are a whole lot of other lines of evidence. Most recently, one of the other stories that you sent us this week to look at was about evidence that's laid down in calcium rings inside giant clams from the Cretaceous period or something or other, and how they showed that back then the day was 30 minutes shorter than it is now, and so forth. So we have a huge amount of evidence as to how the Earth-Moon system has acted over time. Now, as you mentioned, with this impact theory or a hypothesis more correctly labeled, the impactor would have hit the Earth and it would have been on a glancing blow, because anything else doesn't really result in what we observe now in terms of where the moon is, how far away it is, what its orbital period is, the fact that it's tidally locked to Earth, always shows the same face to us and all that sort of thing. So we think we understand how the impact occurred. Now, we have other pieces of evidence which are very important as well. We've been to the moon and we've brought back samples. So the Apollo missions, which ended in 1972, brought back a whole series of samples from the moon. And over the years, these samples have been quite extensively tested. Now, one of the things that we found about the moon, which was not overly comfortably sitting within this giant impact hypothesis, is that the moon and the Earth have, up until now, been thought to have excruciatingly similar oxygen isotope types. And that is not what you would expect.
It's an interesting adjective to use, excruciatingly similar. Who is pained by
this? Yes.
Astronomers.
It's painful because everything else about the model pretty much fits. As you said, it does tick a lot of boxes. That's why it's the leading hypothesis. But it has been, it's been quite uncomfortable, this particular fact. And mainly because it requires a whole lot of special things to have occurred. So for both Theia and Earth to have effectively the same oxygen isotopes at the same levels and the same mix would have meant that, A, they formed in very similar conditions, B, they formed probably in the same area of space, which is possible. It is possible. They might have formed in exactly the same distance from the sun. And then because they were in that same region, that could be why they collided. But that the likelihood that they had the same materials and that they both formed and had long enough to get to the size that they needed to be for the impact to be what it was and to be on the angle that we know that it most likely was, it's very unlikely. And scientists don't like explanations that require things that are really unlikely. Occam had a whole thing about it, right? So it bothers us when we require all of these special things to be lined up.
Yeah.
So that's for a long time been one of the thorns in the side of this giant impact hypothesis. But a team of planetary scientists from the University of New Mexico have taken another look at those old lunar rock samples. And they've found that different sample types, which come from different depths on the moon, actually have quite different oxygen isotope types. Now, So they've just published a paper called Distinct Oxygen Isotope Compositions of the Earth and the Moon. A very accessible title, I might I might point out. I praise them. The team explained that they made high precision measurements of the isotopic composition of samples formed through different processes in different parts of the moon. So there's a whole list of the different types of materials. Some are formed through volcanic melting type activities. Some are formed through almost like glass forming activities. Obviously, we know that the moon has had a lot of lava on it. That's effectively what we when we look up and we see the mare, the seas of tranquility and so forth. They're these really dark regions that have had molten lava. So they tested these samples from different places in the moon that are formed through different processes on the moon. And what they found was that the surface of the moon is likely contaminated with Earth materials from that coalescing. But deep down in the moon, it appears that the isotopes are actually quite different. Now, this matches what we would expect to see in the modeling. In the modeling, we would expect to see that something between 70 to 90% of the moon would actually be material from Theia, not from Earth. But obviously during the Apollo missions, when they brought back these samples and tested the isotope levels and types, they found that they were effectively the same as Earth, or good enough to be the same. So This is very exciting, because this is the first indication that actually there are quite different isotopes there. And that they were specifically observing in these samples that were from quite deep in the moon.
So why is there that difference then between what they found from the original testing of the samples and now? Was it just
yes, good
the
question.
Original one was yep. sort of averaged out or something? Or?
That's exactly what it was. Yes. So from the readings that I did, and I ended up covering quite a few articles of this because I was looking for exactly that piece of information, was what has changed. So one thing that is likely to have changed is the precision with which they've been able to measure the isotopes. So technology has evolved quite a lot in 60 years, and we have a lot more at our fingertips in terms of being able to test these things. So that would be part of it. The second part of it, which was mentioned in only one of the about 8 articles I read, mentioned that In the initial testing, it is likely that the samples were averaged out, and the averaging out basically homogenized it back to what we tend to see on Earth. But that's also likely because the overwhelming volume of samples is more likely to have been from surface rock and regolith, yeah, which is yeah. the dust the particles on the yeah. moon. Right. So those are the ones that are thought to be more likely be, from the remnants of these rings that you mentioned, basically falling onto, what was the proto moon at the time. So covering up, the deeper core, which is predominantly, Theia.
So it's really interesting. Sorry, I can sort of understand why those initial samples would have just sort of averaged out the data, because
yes.
you've only got like this, I don't know if it was a handful or, a truckload or whatever, but you've only got a certain number of samples, and then you're then trying to extrapolate what an entire moon was made of sort of thing. So you're going to be averaging things out and get a general overall mix, but it's only when you yeah. actually pinpoint it and look for the differences that you can find those explanations. So that's really, really cool.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. Exactly. So some other things that this suggested as well is because of the isotopes that they found, it would tend to suggest that they are actually formed further out from the sun relative to Earth before being sent inward on a sort of death run into our neighborhood. So mm-hmm. that's also really interesting because that would tend to suggest a three-body interaction of some sort took place where Theia's orbit was perturbed by something else, and we know that Jupiter has fairly strong impact on many of the planets in the solar system, and certainly the asteroid belts, it does impact, it's got a resonance with the other planets and so forth. So if it formed further out than Earth, it could have formed even further out than Mars, which puts it in between Mars and Jupiter potentially. Who knows? I mean, we don't know, but it could well be that Jupiter sent it in towards us. We don't know, but that would be really, really, really cool, I think, considering how often we talk about it.
And if it formed between Mars and Jupiter, well, there's something else between Mars and Jupiter that we know.
That's right.
It's an asteroid belt there. So it could be that Theia is remnants of, or those asteroids are remnants of what was originally Theia, or some impact that sent Theia towards Earth.
I had exactly the same thought. Yeah. I went down a bit of a rabbit hole trying to find information about isotopes of some of the asteroids that we've visited that we've been able to, and I couldn't really get anywhere with that in the short time that I had, but it is a really interesting thing to think about, because people often assume that the asteroid belt is a failed planet, but there's simply there's nowhere near enough material there. To have ever formed a planet. Nowhere near enough material to form, you know, Mercury with the amount of material that's there. But if Theia came from there and it was, you know what I mean, that who knows? The asteroid belt could be, I mean, this is wild speculation.
Well, yeah.
Wild speculation. But imagine if the asteroid belt was actually the remnants of a collision of Theia with something else in that area of space. That would just be so cool. That would just be... You know, geek out crazy. That's awesome.
I just love that there's 4.5 billion years of history and we're finding that it's full of all these stories and possible collisions and perturbances and mixes, and that's awesome.
I cannot stress how much I love orbital mechanics. I just find it absolutely fascinating.
Yeah.
I really do. It's just such an incredible thing, and I've talked about simulations before that you can actually run yourself, where you can play around with multiple bodies and see what just making minor tweaks to their orbits actually does to them. Yeah. And it's really, really fascinating. I should also mention there are some animations online that you could probably find pretty easily Googling that show some of the models of the Earth-Theia impact. And you can see very much what I mean by this glancing blow. If it was a direct collision, which is one of the things that would have had to have been the case if the two bodies had effectively fully homogenized, so that their isotopes were just so blended in together that they were indistinguishable from each other. That was one of the potential explanations as to why we were not seeing different isotopes. But if that were the case, it would have had to have been a much more direct blow that blew them both to smithereens. And we simply haven't been able to construct a model that results in what we see now that was from a direct blow. So this is a matter of ticking off some of the previous problems with the giant impact hypothesis that now make it a lot more appealing. And for many years, this has been, as I say, the major sort of thorn in its side. So, yeah.
Like all good science, it answers a lot of questions and asks more. So,
yes, and it keeps old Ockham happy, which is always good.
Definitely. Okay, well, I think that's our show. As always, all the links we talked about are in the show notes and on the web at scienceontop.com/353. And if you go to scienceontop.com/donate, you can sign up to Patreon and help us pay the bills. Thank you to everyone who has. And thank you, Penny and Lucas.
Thanks, Ed.
Thanks, Ed.
And thank you, everyone, for listening. We'll be back again next week, putting science on top of the agenda. Join us then.